you for watching this presentation. So the research I will describe involves work conducted on Plum curculio and apple maggot fly in Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and Vermont over multiple years. So this is what I will discuss in the next 28 to 30 minutes. So for Plum curculio, I will spend about 15 minutes discussing an attract and kill strategy to kill Plum curculio adults using synthetic lures and insecticides. It's called the trap tree approach. And then I will also discuss how to kill larvae in the soil using what is called entomopathogenic nematodes. That means insect killing nematodes. For apple maggot fly, I will present the results of new research that has been done, what started in 2019, and we're going to continue this year. That will take me maybe just 5 minutes. And after that, I think that will be the most interesting part, I hope. It's going to be a new research project, which is going to be, which started 2 years ago, but it started by grafting trees with multiple cultivars, which are very attractive to multiple pests, in particular Plum curculio and apple maggot. So I will spend maybe 10 minutes on that. And I would like to say that we, meaning growers, other researchers in New England, extension personnel, and I, were really, really determined to try to kill Plum curculio. I mean, what is the best IPM tool that we can develop to control Plum curculio and apple maggot? And I would like to thank, before I start, growers. And in particular, I would like to thank Stephen Wood from Poverty Lane Orchards. And he has been doing IPM for more than 35 years. I suppose everybody knows him. And when I came back to Massachusetts in 2018, by the way, my PhD is from Massachusetts, from UMass. I was gone for 15 years, so I'm back in April 2019. Just 4 days after I came back, I was already talking to him in his orchard. So we're discussing research, and some of these ideas and work that has been done is because we engage in discussions and brainstorming in sessions. So thank you to Steve for a lot of ideas and input. So developing effective attract and kill strategies has been one of my research goals for more than 20 years. So maybe I look a little younger than I am, but it has been more than 20 years doing work on this area. So attract and kill systems influence insect behavior through the olfactory system via smell. Sometimes you can integrate visual cues, like the yellow color or the red color for apple maggot fly, into this system. So examples of attract and kill systems include bait stations. You can see some examples in the pictures on top. That includes the apple maggot spheres. That will be a bait station. Some mass trapping systems that you can use to control, for example, Japanese beetles. There is also what is called protein bait sprays against fruit flies, but that will not include apple maggot. That will be different insects. But also, attract and kill systems include trap cropping and trap trees for Plum curculio. So for any of these systems, one key component is the use of attractive lures, odor, for example, insect pheromones and plant volatiles, so that you can bring the pest to the area that you are targeting, for example, a trap crop, and then you can kill them with insecticides. So the focus of this presentation will be on attract and kill systems. And for the last 8 years, I would say even more, we have been trying to develop an IPM system for controlling Plum curculio that integrates two components. One is the attract and kill approach using what is called benzaldehyde and grandizoic acid. The grandizoic acid is the Plum curculio pheromone. So when you bait trees with this lure, it becomes a very powerful attractant for Plum curculios. So they congregate on those trees where you can kill them with insecticides. Then when the fruit is infested and drops to the ground, the larvae are going to exit the fruit and they're going to pupate in the soil. Then you can release the nematodes to kill the larvae in the soil, because these aggregations of Plum curculios are going to result in aggregations of injury meaning that you are going to have more fruit infested, which means that you can apply the nematodes in the soil and kill more than if you apply nematodes anywhere else in the orchard. So this is the main idea of what I will be discussing. And this trap tree approach for plum curculio control, it was around 2003 when Ron Procopy at UMass, in discussions with Stephen Wood and other growers, they had the idea of using this lure to bait these trees so you can spray only those trees in the perimeter, just a few trees, and then you don't have to spray the whole orchard after the petal fall spray, which is, you have to do it anyway. So this work has been done for more than 15 years. The idea is that most plum curculios spend the winter in the woods. In the spring, they start moving into the orchard. During bloom, you can bait those trees, which are represented by the red circles. And after the petal fall spray, which again targets the whole orchard, after that, you only spray these trap trees. And there was the work that was done in 2005 and 6, which is in the paper. The comparison was trap tree approach versus perimeter row sprays. Just in a few words, just to be very brief, the percent injury in the trap tree plots, the whole block injury, it was no different from injury when you have the perimeter row sprays after the petal fall spray. And this resulted in about 70% reduction in insecticide use when you use the trap tree approach compared to perimeter row sprays. But when you compare the trap tree approach versus the conventional approach, which is three full blocks of insecticide, the reduction is actually almost like 93%. So now, that was just a background information for what has been done. So in 2013, Dr. Tracy Lesky from USDA in West Virginia, she also got her PhD from UMass, she was comparing the efficacy of the odor baited trap tree approach against the grower control, which is the grower decided how to control the plum curculio, but in most cases, this involves perimeter row sprays after the petal fall spray. So here is a data set that we have, actually we have 27 data sets. Every single orchard that participated in the study is listed. You can see that the only two orchards that actually participated in the whole study, 6 years, it was in New Hampshire, Apple Hill and Poverty Lane. So when I came back in 2018, I couldn't do the study, but it was done at UMass in 2019. So we have again, 7 grower cooperators, including UMass, and 27 data sets, because this was done over a 6-year period. I would like to use one example to describe the experimental approach in a very brief way. So this is one example with the Apple Hill Farm. This is the block that we used in 2018. The work again was done for 6 years. And we compared two different treatments. The yellow dots means that that will be every single trap tree that was baited with benzalahyde and pheromone in the perimeter. And the red line means that will be the plot where there was perimeter row sprays. So at bloom, we deployed 4 benzaldehyde dispensers and 1 pheromone dispenser. The cost is about $20 per tree. And that was, you can buy it, it's commercially available. So in this particular orchard, Apple Hill, what you can see is there were 20 odor baited trap trees. Each one was baited with benzaldehyde and pheromone. And then at petal fall, Chuck sprayed an insecticide to the whole orchard, the 2 blocks. That was a cleanup spray, it has to be done. And then after the petal fall spray, he sprayed only the trap trees, which are the yellow dots, or just the perimeter on the red line. One more example from New Hampshire is Poverty Lane Orchards. So again, you can see the 22 trap trees in 6.2 acres, 2.7 acres for the perimeter row sprays, that will be the control block. And I will present now the results. And it's going to be a chart. with the mean injury, percent injury by Plum Curculio, comparing these two treatments every year. So the blue arrow shows the injury on the trap trees, the average of per trap tree, and the orange arrow is going to show the average injury in selected trees in the perimeter that we use as a control. So we're comparing baited versus non-baited. So here is the figure. In 2013, well, I would say every single year, from 2013 to 2019, there was a significant increase or aggregation of injury in those trap trees because we're baiting them with the lure. So in comparison, what you can see in the orange bars is that injury in the perimeter row blocks, on average, across all orchards, it was no more than 2.5%. That would be the average injury in general you will get if you control Plum Curculio with perimeter row sprays. So significant difference. And the difference was 3.8-fold in 2019. You can see that it was significant. I mean, it was a difference statistically, but it was only close to 4 times more attractive, the trap tree more attractive than the control tree. But when you go to 2015 and you make the ratio, so the trap trees, trips were about 26 times more attractive than any control tree in the perimeter. So the next figure is going to show mean percent injury in the interior of the blocks according to treatments. So we sample a lot of fruit in every block, every year. You can see, for example, the violet rectangles. So that was the area where we collected about 400 fruit. Well, not collected, we just inspected the fruit on the tree and we recorded the injury. So the blue bars is going to be the trap tree plot and the orange bars are going to be the perimeter row sprays. What you can see here is that statistically speaking, the level of injury by Plum Curculio to fruit sample from interior trees, it was no different in trap tree plots or in control plots. In most years, injury was less than 1%. However, in a couple of years, injury was close to 1.5% in interior. That could be due to coverage or weather conditions. So the next topic I would like to discuss is the use of entomopathogenic nematodes, EPNs, to kill Plum Curculio larvae in the soil. So this work was also done for 6 years, 2013-2019. So there is a paper reporting the results. So what you see on top, on the right, is a larva of a wax moth. So entomopathogenic nematodes are almost microscopic. They're very tiny, and they kill insects in the soil because they release a bacteria that is going to go into the insect and then do the killing. And then the nematodes are going to be absorbing the nutrients from this solution. What you see on the left are the cages that we have been using to do the research. So then maybe you're wondering, why do I want to kill Plum Curculio larvae in the soil? What's the purpose of that? Well, I would say that number one, by doing that, you can reduce populations for the following year. And number two, you may also be able to reduce feeding injury because Plum Curculios during the summer, they have to feed. The summer generation, they have to feed. And most likely they're going to be feeding on apple. So they're going to be poking the fruit and making these type of scars. So you kill them before they emerge as adults. You can reduce populations and you can reduce possibly injury by feeding activity. Just two quick examples. In 2018, we work in six different orchards. We use about 4 to 8 emergence cages, just like this one on the picture. They're about 1 square meter on each side. So then we place 75 apples infested with the Plum Curculio. They're very small apples. We had to collect thousands of them. And we compare two different treatments. One treatment, it was an EPN species, which is a Steinernerma Rio Brave. That was published by Shapiro Ilan in 2011. That was the most effective nematode against Plum Curculio. So we compare the efficacy of this nematode against the control, which is water applied to the nematodes, to the fruit. So the results in 2018, basically what you see here is the mean number of adult plum curculios emerging in these emergence cages. So what you can see is that when you have water, of course you don't kill them. But when you have this nematode, which is, you can see the bar is going to about one nematode, one plum curculio on average per trap. So the difference is about sixfold. And that means that for every six plum curculios that emerge in the control, only one is going to emerge in the nematode. So it's going to be killing a lot of plum curculios in the soil. So we repeated the study in 2019 with a student. In this case, we compared three formulations that you can buy in Arbico Organics, for example. So in the previous study, we got the nematodes from a company. It was a donation. But in 2019, we decided to buy them because that's what the growers will do. They will buy the nematodes and they will apply them. So we compared three different species, including the one that we tested the previous year. Same approach, the fruits collected and then placed on the ground. We applied the different nematodes in different cages. And then we waited several weeks. And then we counted how many plum curculios emerged from the soil. What you can see here is that one nematode species, which is on the left, Feltiae, it didn't work. So we applied this nematode and the number of plum curculios were as high as in the control, which is water. But these two nematodes, Rio Brave and Carbocapse, they both were able to suppress populations in cages. So now we'd like to discuss apple maggot. Let me check the time. I think I'm okay. So some of you will know that Ron Procopy, for many years, he was developing this tool, which is a bait station. Is a red sphere. So around 2003, they came up with the latest design, which is a red sphere, which is not sticky, it's plastic. The bottom, the body is actually plastic. The cap is made of sugar, insecticide, and paraffin wax. And it works very well in combination with a lure. Just to make this long story short, because I don't have much time, this sphere continues to be developed. So there is still research happening, so which means that you cannot buy it. There is no commercial application of this sphere for growers. So then, in the absence of this sphere, can we develop an attract and kill system for apple maggot fly where you can use lures and you can deploy them in the perimeter directly on the trees? No spheres, and then you can spray insecticide mixed with sugar. Well, if you remember, the sphere has sugar, and sugar is a phagostimulant, it's a feeding stimulant. So we had the idea of applying these lures in the perimeter, then spraying against apple maggot using insecticide mixed with sugar in the tank. So this work was done in collaboration with Anna and Glenn Kohler from Maine. We were working in six orchards, three in Massachusetts, two in New Hampshire, one in Maine. There were just two treatments, what I call the attract and kill approach versus the grower control. So the attract component means that we use the lures to bring the apple maggot fly to those perimeter trees. And not only that, because there is sugar, well, the kill component is the insecticide with the sugar. And the sugar, we expected that it was going to arrest to keep the flies longer in the perimeter, and also they will induce to feed. And once they feed and ingest more insecticide, they are more likely to die after the residue has dried up. So you spray on a Monday, well, what happens the next days? The sugar, I would say, in the residue, in the spray, in the foliage, is going to induce flies to ingest insecticide. And we were hoping that this would work. So we also had monitoring sticky spheres in the perimeter of these attract and kill blocks. And we placed four unbaited sticky spheres in the interior to monitor for apple maggot penetration into the orchard, because we didn't spray the interior. So we wanted to really determine how many flies are you getting in the interior. The control blocks, the grower control, there were also unbaited sticky spheres in the interior for comparison. And here are the orchards, three in Massachusetts, two in New Hampshire, and one in Maine. You can see the area of the attract and kill plot on the left, and then the grower control on the right. And you can also see how many lures per block, and the average density of lures, it was about 5 per acre. So the lures are not expensive. The lures are maybe, for 5 lures, it's maybe $10. So you can bait 1 acre with $10, and that will be the cost of the lure. Here are the results when, in terms of trapping, using when you compare the captures in the sticky spheres in the perimeter versus interior. So the blue line shows captures of apple maggot on perimeter row spheres in the presence of the lures. What you can see is that the lures attracted high number of flies compared to spheres in the interior. The orange line is going to be interior spheres in the attract and kill plot, and the green line is the average number of apple maggot in the interior spheres in the grower control. So there is no difference in these two interior blocks or treatments, and there were very few flies in the interior across the season. But the most important piece of information is the infestation. How many larvae, how many fruit was damaged by apple maggot? So what you're going to see is going to be blue bars showing mean infestation data, how many, the proportion of fruit that was infested, which was very, very low, but I will show you the numbers. So the blue bars show infestation data for the attract and kill plot. So there is some variability in results. And the brown bars show infestation data in the data, sorry, in the grower control plots. So in the interior trees, what you can see is that there was about 0.2% infestation in the interior trees in the attract and kill plot. And on average, in the grower control, it was about 0.35, 0.36. So there was no difference in infestation. So we're looking for cooperators for the 2020 season. So we have a PhD student. She's going to be coordinating the work. So we have already 8 orchards. I would like to get 10 or 12. So that means that we need access to 2 blocks, each from 1 to 5 acres. So this is what we're going to do this year. We're going to be placing again the lures every 30 meters. We're going to ask the growers to spray insecticide with sugar just to the perimeter. And then we're going to have a grower control for comparison, where the grower is going to decide how to control apple maggot. Then we're going to be having unbaited sticky spheres in the perimeter, also in the interior, in the 2 blocks, to monitor for apple maggot in populations. Then we're going to be, those spheres are going to be inspected by us once a week. So we're going to be driving to the orchard and count and remove the flies. And at harvest, we're going to be also inspecting the fruit for injury. And we're going to provide you with information. So I don't know how much time I have. I think it's about 10 minutes. How much time I have, George?
You got 10 minutes.
Oh, great, thank you. So now this is a new idea. And you saw the picture of me talking to Stephen Wood. That was a very nice day in April 2018. So we're talking, say, you know, Jaime, the lures are too expensive. Growers are going to be unlikely to use the trap tree approach if you have to pay $20 per tree. I say, yeah, you're right, what can we do? So we're talking, and we thought, well, we know some cultivars are very attractive to Plum Curculio, and some are very attractive to apple maggot. Why don't we do research in this area? So we believe, and also not only us, the funders also believe that this is something that needs to be tested. So there is funding provided for 5 years to conduct research with this project. So USDA NIFA, which is the National Institute for Food and Agriculture, and also the Massachusetts Society for Promoting Agriculture, they provide the resources. So we can do 5 years of research, but my goal is not 5 years. My goal is to go for maybe 10 years of to really determine how likely this is going to work or not. So again, effective commercial lures have been developed for many insects. For Plum Curculio, Bensala Haran Pheromone. For apple maggot, the 5-component blend, etc. But some of these lures, in particular Plum Curculio, they're expensive, or they're not easy to get, or it takes time, or you have to plan, etc. So one alternative, it was to exploit these natural sources of plant odor, the cultivars that are attracted to this pest, and then see if we can develop permanent monitoring sites or potentially permanent killing sites where you can just spray those trees for multiple pests. So each tree is grafted with six cultivars. And six, these six cultivars are coming from input from growers and also from research. And those cultivars are supposed to be very attractive to Plum Curculio and Apple Maggot. You can tell me later if you agree or not with this. So research already started this year because we started grafting 2 years ago. The branches were growing. This year, some blocks, some trees have branches with fruit. So we present some preliminary findings. But the insects that we're going to be monitoring for 10 years or 8, Plum Curculio, Apple Maggot, European Apple Sawfly, Tarnished Plant Bug, Stink Bugs, and other pests. So the concept, I hope you will agree with me, that is easy to do, is cheap, and is grower friendly. So the key question is how effective this is going to be. So I don't have the answer at this moment, but I will probably be able to tell you in a couple of years. So we have these 14 blocks in three different states. 10 blocks are in Massachusetts, 11 blocks are in Massachusetts, 2 in New Hampshire, and a couple of blocks in Maine, I think it's 1 or 2. So you can see the total area with grafted trees, how many grafted trees per block, when we grafted the trees, and the area for the control block, because we also have a control block. So this is going to, well, this picture, I hope it's going to represent what is happening. So we have trees where you have every tree grafted with six cultivars. Red Astrakhan is a magnet for Apple Maggot. Liberty, early season cultivar attracted to Plum Curculio. Dabinet, yellow transparent, which is Lodi. Wixon and Ginger Gold. What I want to point out also is that you have some branches, which of course, that would be the Macintosh tree, for example. I'm calling those branches the rootstock fruit. You can have Plum Curculio injury on those branches with the grafted, or you can have on the rootstock fruit, or you can have no injury. I mean, it depends how effective this is. So in 2020, with help from Anna and Jeremy Delisle, so we started monitoring 12 blocks. For some blocks, it was not the best time to do it because the branches are very small, the grafted branches. But for some blocks, it was a good time to do it. I mean, it was a really good timing because these branches are already producing fruit. So we have sticky cards and white sticky cards that were deployed in April. And every week we were recording captures of European apple sawfly and tarnished plant bug. We had 90 sticky cards in grafted trees, 90 on non-grafted in the same block, and 90 sticky cards on trees which are in a control block. We also have pyramid traps for Plum Curculio unbaited next to the trees. We also have a weekly inspection of fruit to record injury by Plum Curculio to the fruit. This is one picture that it was taken on May 27th in Belchertown at the UMass Orchard. So the grafted branch, you can see, starts right here. So these branches are ginger gold. And you can see in the close-up that they are producing fruit. So we were able to record some activity or some, we got some information from here. So now, what do you see in this picture, not including the apple tree and not including my student? What do you see? Well, I will just go on. I don't know. What you see, if you look carefully, is a plum tree. So that was also an idea from Stephen Wood. Say, Jaime, if we're going to kill Plum Curculio, let's do it in the best way we can. So he got actually the plum trees. I got back, I brought some back to Belchertown. He kept some of them. He shipped some of them to a higher ranker in Maine. So basically we have 3 blocks in which, I mean, one of them is in Belchertown. In these blocks, we have grafted trees. And next to these trees, we have 2 plum trees growing. So this picture was taken on April 27th, and you can see the plum tree, small, but already in bloom. So let's see what happens with this in the next years. And as I said, we're really trying to find out the best way to kill Plum curculio with this research. So I will show you now some results. These are preliminary results from Belchertown. One single date for sampling. There has been multiple weeks, but this is for June 2nd. What I want to do is to present boxes next to the cultivar so you can see the injury on average. Actually, it's not average, it's the total injury for the block. So we have four grafted trees in this block. So for Davinet, there were 27 fruits that we inspected, zero injury. For red astrakhan, there were 30 fruits that we inspected, zero injury. Ginger gold, not too many fruit in those branches, 18, no injury. Yellow transparent or rhodi, 3.5% injury. You can see the total number of fruit inspected in parentheses. Wixon, 4.7% for that particular week. Liberty, 15.4%. And we inspected 110 fruits. But interestingly, you're going to see one more box which corresponds to the rootstock fruit. We found 1% injury out of 100 fruit that we inspected. So when you calculate the average total injury for the whole canopy, you can already see that Liberty is getting more injury than, for example, Yellow Transparent or Davinet. But when you calculate the whole injury, is 5.5% for the whole tree. When you add the whole injury versus or divided by the total fruit sample. What happens when you compare this number versus the non-grafted trees in the same block? So there is like so we have the grafted tree with the plum tree, then we have two or three trees with nothing there. So the following tree, it becomes a non-grafted tree. How much injury was in that tree? Zero. So we inspected 100 fruit, zero injury total for the block. And then we also went to the control block and we did the same, zero injury. So just for this block, and I don't want to really say that I cannot make any conclusions, but just for this block, it could be one reason that we have the plum tree, but the only injury we found, it was on the whole tree, which is grafted tree. I have a second example. This is a commercial orchard that has small trees and the same, about the same date, June 1st. I will show you the same boxes. What you can see is that Davinet, Yellow Transparent, Red Astrakhan, Ginger Gold, Wixon, either no fruit or very few fruit, but there was no injury in those few fruits. Liberty, 16.7% out of just very few fruits, that's what we got. And 17.5% injury in the rootstock. So again, when you calculate the total injury in the tree, which is grafted like as a whole, 6.25% injury by Plum curculio. And this is fresh injury. We know it was fresh, we were marking with a Sharpie. You can compare that with non-grafted trees in the same block, it's almost half the injury. And you can compare that with trees in the control block, which it was 2% out of 100 fruit. So we would like to continue with this research. Of course, this is just the beginning because the branches are very young, 1 year old, 2 year old. What is going to happen in three or four years when you have these branches bigger and stronger with a lot of fruit? So then I would like to invite you to participate in this study. There is no changes to the pest management practices that you do. So if we can do it, we can graft the trees for you, then we can follow the trees for a number of years. Nothing changes, you can keep spraying the way you do. Then it's a low risk project because again, it's easy to do, it's cheap. If it doesn't work in 5 years, you can just remove the branches and you have already your original tree. But consider that we're going to be monitoring for multiple pests. And we're going to be doing the monitoring for you. So I would like to thank a lot of people, collaborators from New Hampshire and other states, students, including my graduate student, Pravina Rekmi. She's doing a great job with this project in Massachusetts, funding different sources. I also want to thank the UMass Cold Spring Orchard staff. And especially I would like to thank a lot of growers because of the nematode work, because of the trap tree work, because of the grafting project. So I think I'm okay with time. Thank you. If you have any questions,